Rebekah from the Art and Needlework Podcast. This is my first episode. It's the pilot one, and I'm hoping to discuss here all the crafts I do, and there's many different types, but I can see in the next few episodes I probably will be talking about the ones I've been doing lately, and that's namely knitting, crocheting, and sewing. But I do all sorts of crafts. I do a lot of watercolor painting, and I do a bit of quilting. I have a knitting machine too, so I do that. I mean, it's knitting, but it's a whole different sort of knitting. You have to think of it in a different way. And I've done a lot of different other crafts in the past, but the ones I mentioned are the ones that have stuck around all these years, and those are the ones I'll be talking about on this podcast. So, I've been crafting for a very long time, but I really got into crafting when I was about 15, and that's when I came across this How to Knit booklet in my mother's sewing room, and the next day I found some needles, so I just decided I wanted to try out some knitting. And with that book, I was getting on pretty well, and then I found some crochet hooks, and that took off really quickly, mainly because of a group I was part of, an online group. The women there were very supportive, and they helped me a lot when I was trying to learn how to crochet. And to this day, I think I crochet a lot faster than I do knitting. It just comes easier for me. So that's where I started crafting a lot. But a few years after I started knitting, I decided to pick up sewing, mainly because that was part of school for a little while, so I learned how to use the sewing machine. And I started making little things for around the house. Like, I remember the first project I sewed was a book cover for my Bible. And then I moved on to some garment sewing, like little tiny baby clothing, little things, dresses for dolls, just so I can get a firm footing with the sewing machine. And hand sewing, and just learning how to hem and how to finish seams. And then in 2008, I thought to myself that I want to do a little bit more. I want to be a little bit more professional in my seam finishing. So I bought a serger in 2008, and that with that serger, I thought to myself that I probably could start making things to sell. So I went on to Etsy and made a shop, started selling my crafts through Etsy and local craft shows and things like that. And this past year in November, I decided I wanted to craft more as a good source of income, start my own business. So I kept with my original name, Art and Needlework, because that does encompass what I do. And I opened an online store called Art and Needlework, and I started selling some of my handmades through that. And I sell things like I knit hats and scarves, infinity scarves, and I sew aprons and things for the kitchen, things for the house, like home goods, things like pillows. And I'm hoping to continue with that for the next year and just try to see how that goes. So, more about me. My family has a fruit and vegetable farm. And this is January, so we're somewhat in our vacation time. But, I mean, it's we're not physically down there, but we're still thinking about it. And we're not out there planting seeds or plants, but we're still ordering the seeds. And actually, my sister planted some onions the other day, so I'm currently living at my home with my dad, my brothers, and sisters, one of which is away at college. I had some time during last year to go to school. I went to a culinary school. I wanted to get a degree in the culinary arts. Some things turned up, and so some things with the family, so I decided the best place for me right now is at home, and I'm hoping to go back to culinary school in the near future, but at the moment I'm going to make crafting my life. What I hope to achieve with this podcast is to take part in the community that's associated with crafting and connect with crafters. I don't have many crafty friends in the area. It's kind of a rural area. I thought this was the best way for me to get out there and connect with people, so I'm hoping this will turn out the way I hope it will. The show notes for this podcast will be on my blog. That's artandneedlework.com. So you can always go there if you need to find a pattern I talk about, or some certain yarn, or a website, or some designer. You can go to my blog and you can see the show notes there. So, I always like to learn about what other people are making and get their spin on it. So, I'm going to have a section in the podcast where I tell about my current projects that I'm working on, because I think always, besides the finished project, I like to know what they're thinking right in the middle of it. So let me do that for you. Okay. So the first one up, I mean, I have so many projects going at the moment. I always do. I'm like one of those crazy crafters that love starting things and lots of things at once. So, this is an afghan I'm crocheting. I'm using this vintage 1974 pattern. I found this in my mom's sewing room. It had some parts of it done already. I don't know who started it. It could have been my grandmother or my mom. But, so I thought, I want to finish it. I have all the yarn here, and I like the pattern. So I thought, I'm going to finish it. I've been actually working on this afghan off and on for the last maybe 8 years. I never really got into it because I didn't know who the recipient would be. And then it just dawned on me that my dad probably would really like this. So, his birthday is coming up in March, so I'm going to try to get this done, finally, for him. It's comprised of 3 wide panels, 2 narrow panels. I'm done with the 3 wide ones, and I'm working on the first narrow. And it incorporates what is called a popcorn stitch. So it's primarily popcorn stitch and double crochet, worked in rows, and then when all the panels are done, you crochet the panels together using probably a slip stitch of some sort, that type of grafting. The original one has tassels on each side, about a foot long. I don't really like the idea of tassels, so I'm probably going to just do... I've seen it on a couple afghans, and I really liked it. It's using a bit of fillet crochet which is you double crochet and then chain two double crochet. It's open square work. And I always like that to be used on the edge of afghans, so I might do it with this one because I think it really matches the overall pattern design. So that's my project there. Okay, the next project is a knitting project I've been working on. Okay, this is a pattern by Amy Herzog, and I bought it maybe about 3 years ago, but never cast it on because things got in the way, and this was just a sweater for me, so I thought, it can wait. So I finally, last Sunday, I thought to myself, I really need to do a pattern for myself, not for the store, not for family member, but for myself. So I took it out, I printed it out, and I noticed that there was an update on it, so I printed out the new update. I bought it through Ravelry, and it's called, I heard this pronounced many different ways. It could be Aislinn, it could be Aislinn. It's an Irish name. It could mean, I've seen it said on the internet that it means beauty. I'm going to call it Aislinn because that's what I've been saying all along. So, I took this a step further with the sizing and everything by using Amy Herzog's custom fit. If you go to her website, you can put in your measurements, like I did here, and just punch them in to the form that she has, and then it generates a pattern specifically for your size. And so you know how many stitches to cast on, where to make the decreases, and all the little bits and details that you would want in your finished sweater. And I did it this way because I wanted to save myself some time and some work with the math. I've knitted a couple sweaters before, and I've always done it by I've done it myself. I figured out my gauge, my specific gauge, and I figured out the measurements I want in the end, and I adjusted it all by myself, and I just thought I'll take a break and have her do it, have her program do it. So, really helpful because one of the sweaters I knitted before, I had trouble with figuring out where to put the decreases at the waist. And so I can follow along with this generated pattern, and then I can figure out what's going on and maybe use that information for the next sweater I do, and get a better visual of what's happening and where to put decreases or increases, and just figure out the what really goes on in a knitting pattern. So it's actually a tool for learning right now, her custom fit. So Aislinn. Okay, it's a cardigan that has lace panels in the front and has a waist tie as well. Has ribbing for the hem on the sleeves and the body of the sweater. And then there's the Eiffel Tower lace design, I think that's what it's called, that runs along the upper edge of the ribbing all the way around. It's a crew neck and has a bit of ribbing up at the crew neck. So the yarn I chose for this project is actually a yarn I got in a giveaway It's willow yarns, and this one's called Everest. I got it in the steel colorway. So I've decided I'll start out with making a swatch in a size 6 needle, like a size 6 needle, and I blocked it and looked at it, and I thought it just was too much of a drape, and the stitches were too large, so I decided to drop it down one size to a size 5 needle, and then it got much better fabric, and it has the drape I want, not too loose, because I think the original one had a pretty good amount of structure to it. So I'm using size 5 circular needles for the entire thing. I'm not doing it in a circle, it's a cardigan, but I just like to use circular needles when even doing flat knitting. So that's my Aislinn or Aislinn sweater. I don't think much else to say about that one. So, the next work in progress is really at its beginning stages. It's a skirt design of mine. I'm hoping to make a pencil skirt for myself. I don't have many skirts, so I thought I would do a pencil skirt design using a mock wrap, maybe something like this, without the buttons. Instead of the buttons, I was hoping to use, I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself. What I want to do is take a pencil skirt silhouette, use this this is lightweight faux suede fabric. I would use this for the main body. For the waistband, I will use this black faux suede, as well as the underside of the mock wrap, where, you know, every time you walk, the mock wrap will flap open a little bit, and then you get a peek of the black on the main body of the skirt. So it's just a little detail I thought was really neat. And so I was looking at the buttons on that pattern, and then that gave me an idea that I would actually use buckles. Well, just to make it look like buckles. So I wanted to, I was on Etsy trying to find some leather, I guess leather tabs and maybe some buckles. But I couldn't really find anything that had the right color, and some of those Etsy stores had the shipping too high for my taste. So what I did was, I thought I could probably make the tabs myself. So I found an Etsy seller in Minnesota that actually sells leather scraps, and I think he does lots of different type of belts and things like that, and he has leather scraps, and he sells it in a lot for around $12. Not bad at all, especially for the small tabs I want to make. So I bought these. This is what I got from him. This is his lot. I got this like chocolate, dark chocolate brown leather, and then we also have this burnt sienna leather color. Both are, I've actually never seen real leather before, as far as I know, so I think this would be considered medium weight, I don't know. But anyways, I'm hoping to make tabs out of these, put, I don't know what about the straps between the two tabs. I don't know about that yet. Maybe I'll use this, maybe I'll use a cord. I'm still trying to figure it out in my mind, but for the tabs, I'm going to take D-rings, those metal D-rings, and make a tab that sort of looks like a square, a rounded square, and then put that up near right here where the buttons are on the pattern here. This is just an example of what I would do. I would draft my own pattern, but I just using this for you to figure out what I'm thinking. So I would use the tabs and the leather cord or whatever I'm going to use near the waist, so it looks like the mock wrap overlay. The front piece here will be attached with the leather tabs and the leather cord. So that's my plan for my pencil skirt. I still need to draft the pattern, and I need to make a muslin I'd rather use muslin than a tissue fitting or anything like that, so yeah, a muslin, sew it up, see if I need to change anything, probably do. So that's my plan for that. Steps to designing a skirt. So for me, I have two ways I typically go, and the first one is I take one of the big four sewing patterns, and that's like Butterick, McCall, Simplicity, things like that. I take one of their patterns I have pretty close to silhouette, and then try to get it close to my size, change the design lines, you know, the main lines to the skirt. Skirts are really easy to change. If you want a wide waistband, just add a few inches in width. If you need to figure out where the darts should go, you want to like rotate them, easy peasy. So skirts are really easy to do in that way. I also have the option of using a sloper. I bought a skirt sloper in my size quite a few years ago, and so I use that sometimes. A sloper is just a basic sewing pattern to work with. You can base all your designs off of that. Typically has two darts in the back, two darts in the front, no seam allowances, pretty close, there's like no designees in a pattern like a sloper. So your bare bone pattern that you can build off of. So I have a sloper, I could use that, but I think I might want to go with choosing one of the big four patterns so I can, you know, get a better feel of what to change. I don't think I've done a mock wrap skirt before. I think my sister did and I was helping her, but I don't quite remember the mechanics of it. So if I, you know, start out with one that has that plugged in already, then I can make my pattern a little bit better and it'll come together quicker. Okay, so those are my current projects. So I wanted to mention that you might also, if you go to my channel, you'll see that I have other YouTube videos. So for the last few years, I've been uploading videos on how to do certain crafting techniques, mainly in the sewing and knitting. So last week I just uploaded a video on how to do a provisional crochet cast on two ways. So if you want to like figure out a different way of casting on for knitting, a special way where you can actually unravel the cast on and have live stitches, which is quite helpful if you're doing directional knitting, you might want to check out that video. Pretty soon I'll be having another video up. I'm almost done with it. It's about the Kitchener stitch. I've noticed that on YouTube, I don't know if this is everywhere, maybe I don't have the right books, but I have been finding it hard to, when you're doing the Kitchener stitch, which is you have live stitches, two pieces of knitting with live stitches, and you're trying to graft them together by using the Kitchener stitch that replicates a knit stitch. I haven't been able to really find any information on how to do both the knit stitch and the purl stitch. So if you're, like, if you're trying to put ribbing together, or, like in my case, I was doing cabling, and I wanted to put two ends together, I wasn't able to find information on that. I mean, there was a couple videos on YouTube, but not many, that went in depth about what's going on. So I thought, well, I don't want to put up a video on that, so I'll be adding that to my channel pretty soon. So that ends our podcast for today. This was my first episode. I hope to continue in this format, but this is my first one, and I don't really know where the right feel for it yet. I mean, I'm just trying it out. So if you have any ideas or suggestions of what you would want to see from me, you can leave it in the comments below, or you can go to my blog, artandneedlework.com, and leave a comment there. And check out my online store. It is artandneedlework.com/shop. If you want to see what I've been knitting or what I've knitted, you can go to my Ravelry projects page. My ID is needles2hook. And I hope to see you again soon.